I'm learning it from the desktop. It's on my phone.
Okay. Still learning.
Still learning. Okay, so welcome to Physio and Live, episode 12. We're in Galway, Eamon.
Yeah.
News this week. We don't have any major news, do we?
Yeah, we do.
We do. Oh, our big announcement. So, sorry. Forgot, I was just some random news. We are so excited to tell everybody about a new service that we're bringing to our Donegal clinics anyway to begin with. So next week, Kath is going to be missing from the clinic from Monday to Wednesday because she's in Cork doing very special training. She's going down to the lymph clinic in Cork, and she's going to complete her training in manual lymphatic drainage. Now, it's a two-part training. It's 6 full days, 3 days now and 3 days in November. But when she's completed, it means that we will be able to do manual lymphatic drainage for all of those patients suffering from lymph problems or lymph swelling after they've had surgery for breast cancer.
So looking at things like putting on wraps and things like that to help reduce the lymphedema, mm-hmm. Looking at things like
manual lymphatic drainage, so the massage
element to it as well.
And with patients who are suffering from or have had a diagnosis of cancer, you have to be very careful with your massage techniques. It's contraindicated in these patients. So this course is especially trained techniques to work with these patients. So we're just really excited to be able to offer
that service to people in Donegal.
In their doorstep, because sadly, as everyone knows, Donegal is one of the biggest affected areas by cancer in the country. And this month is Breast Cancer Awareness Month, so we're really, really proud to be saying that this is going to be starting in the clinic from November. We will follow this up with loads of details on it, but if you or anyone you know is affected by lymph problems or swelling, lymphedema, post-breast cancer surgery, please let them know that this service is coming right around the corner to Donegal to them. We'll have all the details on the ins and outs of it, but Kat will be able to do the measurement up for bandaging and compression bandages, and we'll be able to order them and get them in-house in clinic for you, which will save you having to travel for the service. So yes, that's our big announcement, adding on a really, really special element to the services that we're already delivering. It'll be from our Donegal clinic to begin with, and then we'll see how it goes and take it from there. So yeah, that more details on that to follow.
Good.
Right. Anything else this week?
Kick off. No. Do you want to, about the interviews that we selected one appropriate candidate after interviews.
Yeah, we interviewed last Friday for our position in Barna, and we have offered and they have accepted the post. So watch this space.
More news to follow.
Yeah.
We get all the paperwork. All the I's and T's crossed and dotted first, and then we'll
introduce you to our new physio, which is always exciting. Okay, so let's get started here. It says you've joined the conversation, your phone must be logged into Facebook, that's hilarious. All right, here we go. So we've had a few questions in, and we will go to the first one first. So as I said before, if there's anything else we can help with, just send the questions into us. The first one is about, actually they're both about neck pain, these ones, but the first one says, my MRI shows that I have a disc bulge in my neck. Does that mean I am always going to have pain? All right, so this question is gonna let me dive into something that is a real topic of contention and something that's becoming more and more at the forefront of physio and GP practices as well. So what this person obviously has, we don't know the details, we'll make assumptions here, that they've had some kind of neck pain, they've gone and had an MRI, which is an image of all of the structures in the neck. So an x-ray shows bone only, and an MRI shows all soft tissue. So it's a scan of this person's neck, and it shows that they have a disc bulge. So a disc is a piece of cartilage that sits between the vertebrae in our neck. So our whole spinal column, I'll try and be brief here, Ollie, I can feel him twitching already. Our whole spinal column is made up of blocks of bone called vertebrae. And these are all individually clicked together at the back by joints. Click's probably not the right word. They sit in with joints at the back. So they're all individual pieces. And between these vertebrae is cartilage, which is the disc that you hear people talking about. So cartilage is a material that's only slightly softer than bone. The outside of these discs are hard, and the inside has a bit more water content and is a little bit softer. When somebody says they have a disc bulge, it sounds extremely, serious. But in reality, it is not. A disc bulge is as simple as the outer layer of these discs slightly having little tears, and the inner material can migrate out. Now, in some cases, is this serious? Yes, it is, but it is in a very small percentage of patients. The bottom line is that disc changes over time are as normal as your hair going grey or your skin getting wrinkly. And this is what I want to talk about in terms
of MRI. Some people don't like their hair going grey.
We don't
some
like
it. Some people diet, some people shave it. So what do these people do?
Touching the nerve. I just want to go back to about this MRI situation. So patients come into us with pain, and we know by the symptoms that you tell us if there's something serious going on with this disc, because your symptoms will indicate to us straight away. And in 95% of cases, we are never worried that there's something serious going on because of the disc changes in their neck. But some patients will go off and have scans, and we're doing these scans really regularly, especially in Ireland since we came home. You know, in the UK, not as many of our patients would have had MRI scans because it's through the public system, and because they don't change treatment, they're not routinely given. But in Ireland, everyone and their mother comes through our door with their MRI disc, and they say, I've got a disc bulge at L2-3, mm-hmm. or I've got a disc bulge at C5-C6. And it's sort of this diagnosis that they've been given. But in reality, that disc change might have nothing to do with the pain that they are in. Let me explain. We now have a whole host of really good studies using MRIs in both patients who have pain and patients who don't. And it is really interesting. And after this, I'm going to post an infogram of this information I'm about to tell you, because really it hopefully will reassure this patient in their question. So some of these studies looked at both adults and what they call senior adults, which is over 65. So in the normal population with no neck pain, 98% of them had what would be classed as degenerative changes in the cervical discs. And this was in pain-free individuals. So 98% of people have got disc changes on their MRI. So basically, if disc bulges caused pain, every one of us would be having neck pain.
So why doesn't everyone have neck pain?
Because the disc bulge can be completely symptom-free. It is just a normal consequences of changes over time, and you don't even have to be elderly. The same study looked at young adults, so this was people in their 20s, and 79% of them had changes in their discs, or had shown disc bulges.
So why do the 20%, or why do some people get the pain?
So there's different contributing factors to the pain, and the reality is that when they come into clinic, we'll normally call it mechanical pain or non-specific mechanical pain. So in reality, it is we're not exactly sure, and if we were, then these people wouldn't be suffering on and on and on with pain. We believe that it is a combination of factors. So if you think about it from the outside in, so the disc has nerve endings, so is it contributing, is it not? The joints are covered by ligaments that all have nerve endings that can cause pain. The muscles attached to the bone by tendons, which all can be a source of pain. And then the muscles themselves can be a source of pain. So my point here is that just because you have a disc bulge doesn't mean you have to have pain. And like, this matter is becoming more and more at the forefront of our practice every day. Even this week, I had a patient come in to me who I thought I had reassured about how, you know, their pain wasn't presenting as anything serious. And I got an email from them later on saying, you know, I am really worried about it. Do you think we should just scan it just in case? Now, the problem here is that that person will have a scan and it will show, most likely, 98% of us do, disc bulges. And then that patient will then become nearly apprehensive and anxious that they've got that disc bulge, so that's it.
They're catastrophizes.
Exactly. You start to get apprehensive and worried about these changes on MRI. But reality is that those changes are irrelevant. It will not change how we manage it, and they may not even be contributing to the pain. So I guess what we're saying here is that just because you have a disc bulge on MRI does not mean you're going to be in pain forever. I think the other thing to bring in as well is, you know, what is disc changes? Because the report comes back, all right, they'll get this MRI report back to their GP, and it'll say things like degenerative disc disease, disc bulge, spondylosis, arthritis, all of these terms. And I know for a fact from speaking to my patients that all of this worries the patient. They hear degenerative and they think it's going to get worse. Where am I going to end up? And all of this actually heightens their pain, makes them more fear of movement, and makes the situation worse.
More stressed and anxious, yeah.
So let me clear this up right now. Degenerative disc disease means normal changes to vertebral discs. Arthritis is the term given to normal change, age-related change within a joint. It does not mean that it's going to get worse over time. So I really want all those patients out there who have had scans, and this is the same for people who've had scans of their lower back, don't be a prisoner to that scan result.
Yeah.
You can change your symptoms no matter what that scan says. There's only a tiny percentage of patients, usually with these discs, really compressing on nerves where it needs big intervention. So, yeah, it clearly upsets me because I just see so many people coming in saying, you know, oh, me and my disc bulge, it's my disc, but it's just all so normal. People who do not have pain have these changes, and the only way, you know, they're incidental findings nearly.
But you can't just make it a sweeping general statement that these people that have disc bulges, that they're gonna, you can get rid of their pain. Because some people will always have an element of pain.
Mm-hmm.
So
absolutely.
What are you gonna change for them, or what could you change for them?
So like it depends on how each patient presents, but like if somebody comes in to me and they have a scan that says, you know, they have a disc bulge at C3, C4, like I'm not like, oh my God, we have to be careful of that disc bulge. I know that what I need to do here is look at how that patient is presenting. Are they presenting with reduced range of movement? Are they presenting with joint stiffness when I press on it? Are they presenting with muscle weakness around their neck? And it's those things that I will treat, because those are the things that the studies show us will make a difference to pain over time. And now, don't get me wrong, there'll be some patients whose pain I can't abolish. And there'll be patients out there that have worked with me who will know that I say, look, your pain is here, it's been going on for years, let's just accept that the pain is there, now let's see if we can improve your function in that pain.
So and
these are chronic pain patients, and like I will say that time and time again to my patients, they don't want to hear it because they're fearful of a life with pain. But what we find is that, you know, that person might be off work, they might have stopped doing the things that they enjoy, they might have stopped doing things with their kids, and we set very simple goals. Right, let's see if we can start to walk for 10 minutes a day, might be even 5 minutes a day. So you've got the same amount of pain, but now you're walking 5 minutes a day. And then we up it to 6 minutes and 7 minutes. And a month later, they might be in the same amount of pain, but they're doing a half an hour walk, which means they're getting stronger and they're getting fitter, and they can do more with
quality
the
life is going up.
Exactly.
Despite pain staying relatively constant. But we normally see the pain starts to drop a little bit the more active they do get. Some people just can't abolish. You won't abolish their pain completely. But
no,
you can definitely.
And these patients have spent a fortune.
Yeah.
On different treatments, they might have had surgery, they might have gone to umpteen different specialists, and they come in front of me and they're still in pain. And I'll often say to them, what is it that you're looking for from me? Because manual treatment has been shown to give short-term relief only. So for these patients that are on their ongoing pain, something has got to change in their overall lifestyle, and that's what we try and help with, a graded exposure to exercise and movement to try and help them manage their pain. MRIs give me blood pressure. Look, there's also a category of patient who I recognise can't move forward in managing their pain unless they have that reassurance. But I try and educate them fully before they ever go into any scanner to say that, look, this MRI is going to show changes. Everybody's MRI comes back with something.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, there is, and there's good, there's one or two papers that I was reading as well that said the more like, that those that have MRIs are more likely to have more barriers to overcoming their pain and actually moving forward. So it's not always getting a diagnosis or getting an MRI isn't always the best thing in the world for you. Sometimes it's better to just except providing that, as I said, you are assessed and that there's nothing serious going on,
yeah.
and that it's just kind of moving forward.
And I don't blame the patients here at all, because if I were in their situation and I was having pain, I would want it looked at with the highest investigation. But it's just really important that those patients understand that the changes that will be reported are not to worry about,
just
because patients panic. Like I've had patients come back into me with a sheet of paper in a sense of panic, because they don't have anybody to go through the result with them initially. And there is big terms, and they're scary when you read them. Anything that says degenerative on it does not make anybody happy. Whereas when you say that it's normal change, then it takes that anxiety out of it straight away. And it was a big change for us coming from the National Health Service in the UK, where they were not scanning, really they were only scanning if sinister pathology was indicated. Yeah,
less than 5%
of the patients came through,
yeah,
with MRIs.
Yeah.
Whereas here, all of our patients, or nearly
yeah,
all of
yeah.
them.
Those with back pain and things like that, I would say the majority, maybe 60-70%, have had some form of a scan at some stage on their back or their neck.
And we've had to adjust to that. We've had to sort of look at these MRIs and pick apart what's relevant and what's not relevant. Now, don't get me wrong, some patients really do need that reassurance. And like, I have written back to GPs and said, look, I don't think there's anything sinister on the scan. I can't move forward with this patient at this moment in time because they're still worried something serious is going on. And in those cases, like when people know that they don't have cancer or they don't have tumours, then we really start to make inroads into their treatment. So, you know, it will differ for different patients. So there'll be patients out there that I'll have said, look, we don't need to scan, I'm not worried, and great, we move forward. There'll be other patients that I say that, and then I realise 3 or 4 weeks in, this patient's, there's still underlying apprehension, and then I might link in with the GP and go from
so
there.
So what you're saying is you're just not good at selling it.
No. Sometimes, Ollie, I'm not that good.
Yeah, that's good. Now you heard it.
I've got so far away from this patient's question. So my MRI showed I have a disc bulge in my neck. Does that mean I'm always going to have pain?
Not necessarily. No.
But we would highly recommend that you get your pain assessed by a healthcare professional and get on a treatment plan if need be and get some advice. But a disc bulge does not mean pain for life, because 98% of adults have them when scanned and have no pain. Please remember that fact.
And you can also reduce disc bulges.
So oh, you can't.
A disc is a malleable.
Really interesting. You have a patient who's had a disc bulge with pain, and I need to look at these papers again because it's been a while. But like, you can re-scan a patient who has a big disc bulge, and one of three things can happen: either the disc is the exact same and the patient's pain is completely settled, your body has actually absorbed the disc material. Remember, our bodies are capable of amazing things, like. It can absorb it and the disc is just gone, or the bulge is gone. Or you re-scan it and it has, because it is like a fluid movement, it has actually sort of absorbed it back into place. It can happen. So it's all about treatment and getting the right treatment and advice. And that doesn't happen with manual treatment. Manual treatment eases the superficial symptoms, the muscle spasm, it feels good for a day or two. That happens through the right movement and advice, and to reduce patients' fears so that they move normally. That's what we're known from the research. Movement is key.
Right, move on. Next question.
Oh my golly, I've harped on very long about that. Okay, the next question. Okay, this is another neck one. So I sit at my...
Re-quarantine here this week.
Yeah. I sit at my computer most of the day for work and I'm getting a pain in the back of my neck. Is this serious, and is there anything I can do about it?
Right. No, and yes. Short and sweet, we're done. if only it was that simple. Right, so no, it's not necessarily anything serious, but it's always good to get it checked to make sure that there is nothing serious.
What are the signs that it would be more serious?
Unrelenting pain, unexplained pain. When I say unexplained, so... there's nothing that you do and that brings it on. It just comes on randomly throughout the day or at night. Unremitting night pain, so when you're lying in bed at night and it just doesn't let up. or pain, particularly in the second half of the night, that it really starts.
These are all signs to get pain checked out, not to panic you. It's just to get it checked.
Kind of night sweats and things like that as well, where you're just sweating profusely at night. So that would be kind of telling you that you need to get that checked quite quickly. But
if it's
referred pain coming down the arm,
if you're losing power in your hand, numbness, pins and needles, it's getting worse, all of those things, you need to get to your doctor or your health, your physio, to get it assessed to see if it's something that we need to look at.
Yeah.
But if it's just a bit of neck pain here from sitting at your desk, we see this all the time.
We do. So you need to have a look at your workstation, is what I would say. Have a look and see what kind of chair you have. So you want a good supportive chair, ideally. You want something with a bit of a lumbar support. I'm saying it now, sitting in a nice wooden stiff chair. So you want something with, can you see me?
I can.
Something with a bit of a lumbar support, just here in the base of your back. So in against here, and when you're sitting in the chair, you want to sit right back into it and take the support from the actual chair itself. Can you see me? You can.
Yeah.
So you want to sit back in, take the support from the chair, and then you want to make sure that your feet are, a bit further away. You want to make sure that your feet are supported as well on the ground. If your feet can't reach the ground, it's okay.
Happens to dollies sometimes.
Short legs, it does. So it's okay to put like something underneath your feet, like a stool, or you can even sometimes turn a basin upside down, an empty basin that is upside down. Then also it's important that you have your elbows supported. So ideally, if you had arms in your chairs, they would support the elbows, and then you'd be at the correct level, where your hands are just kind of resting at your keyboard. You'd bring your computer and keyboard towards you, or you'd pull your chair in close enough to the desk so that you're not leaning forward. The biggest thing that we would see with people sitting at desks is we tend to sit on the edge of the chair, and then we tend to slouch or slump forward, and we poke the head out, and that's all putting extra stress and pressure right through the back of that neck. And we come into this kind of what we call a kyphosis, where we're really just rounded shoulders and we're just in that position working all day long. Now, I myself get into that position, and that's not...
There's nothing wrong with it.
It's not the worst thing in the world, but the problem is when you spend too long a period of time in one position. So the best thing, you can sit in the best position in the world, but if you sit there too long as well, your back is going to stiffen up, your muscles are going to start to give you pain as well. So the most important thing, sitting at your desk at work, is to get up, change your position regularly.
Mm-hmm.
So 20 minutes, half an hour, just get up, walk, even to the water cooler, to the toilet. Doesn't even have to be.
You can just stand up and sit back down.
Exactly. Even if it's just bending down, touching your toes, twist from side to side, and then even doing some pelvic tilting, so rolling up and down with the lower back, just to try and break that monotony, so it takes the stress out of the tissues. So remember, the tissues in around the lower back, in around the neck, and they all start to become really, really tight. It restricts blood flow because there's no movement going on between those tissues, between the muscles. So everything just starts to get like a build-up, basically, of nice toxins and chemicals in around the area, and that can all start to feed in and give you loads of pain. So regular movement is good. Now, other things then that you can work on are trying to do some stretching and trying to work on getting a better control of your posture as well. So you'd be doing some rows if you're in the gym, or even some band exercises where you're pulling back to try and recruit the muscles at the back, because often it's the anti-gravity muscles, so our back muscles, our extensors, that tend to give in to gravity, that we tend to slump. Gravity just pulls us into this position.
And you can even do that at your desk. I often give that to my patients around my desk,
just to squeeze
the shoulder blades
together,
and then even
seconds.
Stretch it out in the other direction.
And squeeze, if you need to, you can obviously take paracetamol and pain relief if you need to, using heat is also a good one. Again, hot, cold.
We had this argument last week.
I know, don't want to keep going back to the same argument. I would tend to use heat, particularly for necks.
Because it's not an acute pain, like it didn't just happen like that. It's usually gradual build up over time.
Yeah, so look at your workstation, change your position regularly.
Mm-hmm.
Avoid cradling the phone between your ear. That's an awful one. So we tend to see people, they say they're on the phone quite a bit, and they cradle it here and then they're there. If you can put it on speakerphone or get a headset, it's so much better for the neck than to actually try and cradle it.
Something, just to finish that one on with desk and postures, a shout out to an old colleague of mine in Portsmouth. People get obsessed with the perfect posture. The perfect posture doesn't exist. The perfect posture is the next posture. So movement is key. If you sit like this all day, I promise you, you'll be coming into us with lower back pain. It is just being in the most ideal position, but moving regularly is absolutely key.
Yeah, so again, it's just getting that blood flow in around the muscles, it's pumping action, so it's not allowing it to build up and stiffen up and get nice and tight.
One more quick one. We have someone in here who's asked, anything you advise to help a sore shoulder from feeding / holding baby?
Get the other half to do it. Always
well,
works.
Not if they're breastfeeding, that won't work quite as well.
Alright, give me that one.
Okay, so this is a common one with new mums, so congratulations if you're a new mum, first of all. This one is tricky. We often see patients coming in with shoulder pain and sore shoulder, from especially in those early days when you're feeding so regularly. So it's a bit like what we said with the previous question, is make sure your own posture is as good as it can be when you're feeding. So make sure you're supported. Pillows are your absolute friend, both for you and for the baby, so that when you're holding in that position, that you're not actually holding the weight of your arm, that you're trying to stack up pillows around you. So you're, you know, in a good, you can be on the sofa, like, and pack the pillow around you, but make sure that that arm is actually resting on the pillow and you're not holding it in space. So you need the support under there. So it's actually just sitting there.
So it's not putting tension through the shoulder.
Exactly. And then obviously changing it regularly from one shoulder to the other. If you're bottle feeding, moms have a very bad habit of feeding on the same side every time. So just immediately stop that. Do one side one feed and the other side the other feed. Switching it up again, which just changes the muscles that are doing it, but supported on that side as well. Thinking about the positions that you can feed in. So on those early days, baby feeds really well if they're propped up carefully beside you on a pillow, and you can actually, you know, lie or sit beside them with the bottle rather than you constantly holding in that arm as well. If you Google safe positions to feed baby in, you'll see some of the images there. So if the shoulder is very sore, we think about alternate. Even breastfeeding and side lying is a real easy one as well to take the pressure off the shoulder. But obviously you have to make sure that baby's in a safe position, so double check if you're unsure. The other thing is to try and do a little bit of shoulder work for yourself, because as baby gets bigger, they get heavier and you end up lifting. So I often say to mums, if they're finding a niggle early on, get it seen to straight away. So if this persists, try those little tips that we give you. If it persists, just get it checked out. Get yourself popped into your local physio, which I know is really hard when the baby's little. Take the baby with you. The physio will be able to give you a few good exercises to try and keep the strength in your shoulders. Usually I get them to do some stuff when they're lying down at night with the arm just overhead, maybe with a little bit of weight up and down. But
it just depends on what's comfortable.
Yeah, exactly. But even if you just get a one-off appointment when you can, and they'll be able to show you the strength exercises to do. Because what happens is, I end up not seeing them until 3 or 4 months down the line, and at that stage, you know, they're struggling with even the basics left in the kettle. So watch your position when you're feeding. Don't have the arm hanging in space. Make sure it's supported from underneath. Switch regularly, and if at all possible, particularly if you're not breastfeeding, hand that baby around. Give yourself a break.
Offload. Bit of heat, and get the other half to massage. Nice shoulder neck massage. Absolutely.
God, this all sounds great, doesn't it? Sound like you're going to be a great dad, really?
Yeah, sure.
All right, on that note, it is now 28.
Right. Have a good Friday.
Thank you so much for watching, guys.
Hope everyone made it through the storm okay. We didn't really get much of a storm in Donegal, to be fair. Galway got a bit more.
My
own parents are still without power. What are we, five days?
Day five with no electricity. Smelly in that house.
Cracking up. No TV. Right.
Which means they can't watch Fizzy Around Live because their power is down. Batteries
and stuff. Sorry, I'll record
that. Anyway, we're harping on. Thanks for watching, guys, and I'll post all that info about our new lymphatic drainage service soon. Bye!